So we're back to looking at the Series 3 gearbox. Just having a look at the layshaft end float. The manual describes that the layshaft should have a minimum of end float, but definite. And what it says to do is to loosen the layshaft bolt a couple of turns so you can get hold of it, and then feel it. You should be able to feel a small amount of end float. It's not very scientific because the bolt naturally has a little bit of slop in the threads. It's just, you know, the way these things are made. So kind of difficult to tell. Unless you put a DTI on the end of the shaft perhaps. But anyway, as I see it, there's no reason for the lay shaft to float in the bearing itself. You're just looking for the end float of the bearing, which will be somewhere around 1.5 thousandths. Basically it's a check to ensure that the lay shaft isn't binding, and I'll show you why. Now, I've now put the largest spacer in, and I'll show you those in a minute, and you can see the end of the lay shaft is actually making contact with the bearing, and the lay shaft, the bell housing, has not seated on the case of the gearbox, so I know that the space is too big. Now you could throw all that together and it would probably work, the gearbox would be tight, but you'd never really know until it went wrong. With the main shaft in there, you just wouldn't see that. So you can see we can get this shim's about 20 thousandths. We can slip that in there quite happily. So these are the spacers for the lay shaft, conical spacers, and they're in quite a range of sizes, the smallest being 404 thousandths thick. And the thickest is in there at the moment, it's about 445 thousandths. So basically a millimetre up on that. So I'm going to put a small one in and then see what it looks like again. I've just got that together and there's now no clearance between the bell housing and the casing. It's settled down nicely. It now turns over with the noise, as you can hear. I'm pretty sure from previous investigation off camera, what that is a constant gear up in there rubbing on the back of the lay shaft bearing carrier. There's some bolts that stick out slightly, so we probably need to put a slightly larger washer in. But anyway, it all turns nice and freely, which is very good. Just feel the slightest end float, which is the bearing itself. That's very good. And I've now got a bent piece of shim stock, and I should be able to slip that underneath the back of the lay shaft between it and the bearing race, which I can with quite a bit of clearance, probably 35 thou clearance at an estimate. So I'm very happy with that. So we need to investigate what's rubbing in there now. Okay, it was a false alarm. You'll notice that, well, obviously that one's a hole for a stud. You've got a large hole there and then two smaller ones. Probably can't see it, but if you measure them you'll find that these are smaller, and that's for bolts that act as dowel pins in the casing. The bolts are all the same size, it's just the hole in the case that's different. And if I put them in, the noise went away. Just the helical gear slightly out of mesh, but that was my fault. Anyway, I'm quite happy with the bearing clearance. It wasn't the most scientific of checks we did there, but it was enough to be able to see that everything's going to run all right. We've got clearance behind the bearing carrier at the front, the constant gear in the primary line up dead on in the middle, constant gear is tight on the lay shaft, it's secured in place. And we've got clearance at the back end, so we'll take all this apart and we're ready to progress the build. We are actually about ready now to do final assembly of the gearbox, but I just wanted to show you what it says in the manual about the layshaft bolt. I mentioned this nylon locking patch. And it says here that if the layshaft securing bolt has a nylon locking patch, it should be discarded in favour of the latest standard set bolt. It's moved with Loctite 601 and tightened to 50 pound foot. Now that's what I did with the last one, and it would appear to be fine. If we come further through the manual to the description of assembling the gearbox, it says here that we should tighten the layshaft securing bolt 60 pound foot. Well, I'm not sure which piece of advice superseded the other, but just about everything I've seen regarding the Series 3 layshaft bolt says 50 pound foot and plenty of Loctite. Right, so we're about ready to actually put the main box together. Then the easiest thing is to put the main shaft in first. It does help if you grease this rear thrust washer and stick it to first gear. That seems to make it a little bit easier. It's quite a fiddle this stage. Once this is in, we have to press this into the bearing bearing housing in the back of the gearbox. You can drive it through with a hammer, in fact that's actually what it says to do in the manual, but it's a lot nicer with a press. You're just pulling reverse gear forwards and out of the way. As I remember, with the reverse gear in, slip first gear forwards, pull reverse towards you, lift it over, and it clears it. And then you've got to wiggle it all back onto the shaft again, like that. Right, that's about it. And now we can press that in. I think we're actually there. Well, I probably made that look far more difficult than it should be, but the main shaft is now in there. Everything turns as it should, apart from first gear, but there is a sometimes misleading problem where the bulk rings can get stuck on the synchronizer cone on the gear. Nothing to worry about, and the way to tell if that's happened is that with the hub in the neutral position, second gear synchronizer hub in the neutral position, you can get hold of first gear. You can hear this sort of backlash. Well, that's the notches for the bulk ring. They have about, I don't know, 1/8 of an inch sort of clearance either side. And I can just feel the gear moving, so I'm fairly sure that once it's all together, we could lock that up and the bulk ring will break free. But it's just something to be aware of, they do that. I can also feel that the end float is exactly what it should be. It feels just like it was on the bench, so I'm happy with that. So now we can try and get the lay shaft in. Well, I didn't catch it on film, unfortunately, but I've got the lay shaft in now. There's no more to fitting it than trying to drop it into the bearing at the back. For that, you've just got to get it pretty much dead square, else the rollers won't drop in, as I've said. So it's just a case of fiddling about. It's taken about 20 minutes to get it to go in there, but it has. And you can see what I mean now about the bulk ring that's locking everything up. That will free off. Right, we can now fit the source of all the usual trouble, the third, fourth synchroniser hub. Nice new one. I mentioned previously about this counterboard area, recess. You can see the ends are quite different, but if you weren't looking for it, you might not spot it. So that counterbore down, and we can just drop that in there. Although, of course, I've put some special marks on it. Normally, you wouldn't line it up, you'd just drop it on, but because of the way I've sorted that shelf, I want to fit it exactly the way I know it's going. But I did get on the Synchro Gearboxes about that as well, and they said they would have had no problem replacing it for me, but I just let them know, so they're going to check those out, make sure that nobody else gets caught out. Goes on there like that. We're about to drop the bell housing onto the main gearbox, so I've got a couple of studs in, the little needle roller bearings in there, the constant gear just resting on top of the lay shaft, just ready to sneak the primary pinion underneath. Grease that, stick it to the gear. Should be a bit easier. The gasket's in place with sealant, which is Heldite. It's a Tisnet gasket, which came from HNJ Engineering. Quite a nice quality, and of course it fits straight away. I've never had any issues with any of their products. Let's see what happens. I have to say, I'm rather suspicious of how easily that dropped on there. Part of me says the spacer on the lay shaft is falling out. Let's put the bolt in and see what happens. wind up the layshaft bolt, see what happens then. I'm a bit concerned that that spacer might have fallen out, but would I? Don't feel too bad. There we are, so next time we'll move on to fitting up the seal into that clutch withdrawal unit there. We've got to properly torque the layshaft bolt with Loctite. And there's some bits to go on the rear of the main shaft too. All turns nicely. I'm confident that that layshaft spacer is actually okay. You can feel just the right amount of inflow there, just the inflow in the bearing. I'm very happy with that. Well, I've been busy working on the Land Rover today, or bits of it in the workshop at least. And I've just finished converting this SUHS6 float chamber top to have a proper overflow. At the moment it's just got a drilling on the one that's fitted where that brass plug is. So we'll actually be able to pipe the overflow away now. If ever it floods, it'll not do any harm. And when on off-road tracks, you won't get fuel splashing out onto the top of the carburetor, which has been a problem in the past, so a very much safer thing. But we'll come back to that in a future video. I've also done a top fill and dipstick conversion on the gearbox, or just trying it out really. I'm going to take this off for now as it's a bit vulnerable to damage while it's on the bench. But this is a Global Roma dipstick. They come with the Roma drives. It's intended for the transfer box, but I've already got one on there. And I thought there's no reason really why I couldn't put one on the gearbox. I'll probably either put a bend in it or shorten the fittings to get it right close into the gearbox. There's a plug in the side of my transmission tunnel, so I'll be able to access that. And we'll probably need to put one on the top for this as well. Well, we will need to put one on there. This is a series one part, this spring clip, and I've just modified the detent spring plug there to have a register for that to turn on. Threaded it for the bolt, and this is the original breather cap for the Series 3 gearbox. So a little cork gasket in there, and I've just replaced the plastic breather with a little brass one with a hole in it. They only ever had a little drilling on them originally on the earlier models, and that was all they needed, so that's all I've done. Anyway, very simple conversion, and it'll make life an awful lot easier in the future. Right, on with the build then. So the next thing to go on is this oar slinger. So I'm just going to put a little bit of grease on the bit the seal runs on, just to help it along. This gearbox is likely to get stored for a while as well, so any grease will just help it prevent any corrosion. One thing to bear in mind, I think I've said previously that the main shaft nut coming loose is quite a common issue on series Land Rovers. If that happens, this of course is not likely to be clamped properly against the main shaft. So if you've got oil transferring between your gearbox and transfer box, might be worth checking that out. Grease is good on splines as well, don't ever use copper slip. Now this is a output gear. This is what you would have as standard. My Land Rover is equipped with a Roma drive, as I've said, so we'll be swapping that on. If you've got a fairy overdrive or a Roma drive, you replace this with something else, but the principle is much the same. That goes on with the splines outwards. We've then got this little washer. This is the lock washer, and the little tangs then go up the splines. And then the main shaft nut, for which we'll then need this special tool later on, special tool 600-300. We'll come back and torque that once the selectors are in. So we're going to put the selectors in now, and once the selectors are in, that will allow me to lock the box up and tighten the rear, the main shaft nut and the lay shaft bolt at the front. So first thing I'm going to do is just loosely fit the lower seal retaining plate. Now the selector seals in these boxes are one of the common leak points. You often see these gearboxes, in fact almost always, with a little drip of oil on the sump plug. And it's not the sump plug it's leaking, it's these selector seals, and the oil runs down the side and then drips off underneath. Now I have been experimenting with a number of like auxiliary seals which seem to work quite well, so I'm going to go away and refine that. But for the sake of this video, I'll show you how it ought to be done. So we've got the different selectors. This is the reverse gear selector fork. This is first and second gear. And then that is the third, fourth selector. You've also got the reverse gear gate. We'll set that up and adjust it when it's on the gearbox, but I've just fitted some new springs, and you will find that very much easier if you take those bolts out, remove this bit, fit the springs between these two points first and then put it all together. It's very much easier that way, and you can actually get them properly hooked on the inside. If you hook them on the outside, you'll find they come off. There should also be a Loctite on there. I've just gone for Loctite in this case, which will do just as well. I've also come up with my own sequence for putting the selectors in, because the manual, I've followed that through and found it difficult in the past, so I've just developed my own way of doing it. So the first one we're going to put in is the reverse. Reverse gear shaft has an O-ring in the seal kit. Get a bit of grease on there. So you see these a little groove cut out for the selector pinch bolt. And you'll also notice there's quite a bit of free play on these, so leave them loose when you first put them in. This is the point at which, of course, reverse gear slides away down the box. Yeah, so we've caught reverse gear and we can just drop the O-ring into the groove there. Okay. So now it's the second gear selector fork. Now my technique differs somewhat from the manual in that I just put the fork in at this stage. So I'll take the pinch bolt out. And then we can just drop that onto first and second gear. That's engaged. I should have said previously that you may need to bring the selector hub part of the third, fourth synchronizer hub back this way, and you can do that if you turn the box and you very gently pry it with a screwdriver or some other suitable implement. But it should snap back towards you, engage third gear, and that makes getting the third, fourth selector in a lot easier, which we're now going to install. The reason I'm using a bit of grease is that this box is going to sit in storage for just a little while, and the grease will stick around. And we can now feed that on the selector rod, of course, this time, into the box. So for third, fourth selector rod and first and second, you've got these square section O-rings. These are, unbelievably, they're undersized. They're slightly loose fit on the selector shaft, and they're actually loose in the housing, so they won't do a lot other than wiping when the selector rod is operated. So that's why I'm looking to improve them. They're really not very good. Again, it's got a divot for the pinch bolt, cut out, whatever you want to call it. Let me just slide that on there. So again, leaving the fork loose. Bit of a tight fit, but there it is. Push the seal into place. And that's engaged. And now we need to get the first and second selector shaft in. Now in this one there should be this little interlock device, little pin in there. And because we dropped that in there, it's necessary now to feed that through the hole in the bell housing. Lift up the selector. And feed it back through. And that is very, very much easier than struggling trying to get the whole thing in with the selector rod attached. At this point we can torque up the light shaft and main shaft bolt. Now we've got the selectors in. So I've knocked this selector forward, which puts us into fourth gear, matching the input to the output speed. And then if we shove the reverse fork back, that's it, we've locked up. So now I'm going to find something I can strap this down to, because the layshaft bolts are fairly high torque, and it's quite good if you can hang on to the torque wrench with both hands. Likewise, the main shaft nut. There is a good reason for torquing this up at this stage when it's not going to have this gear on it when it's all done. The reason is that I want to make sure everything's settled properly, that the shaft, the main shaft's actually pressed right through the bearing. Tightening it up should do that, and just avoid any problems once I've installed it in the vehicle. It would be really infuriating to find a problem by the time I get to the stage of fitting the overdrive. So we'll do the whole job on the bench, and then we'll know it's right, even if we're doing things twice. So this is a job for the Loctite 601. Plenty of it. These make a bit of a mess if they come undone. way there, but never mind. And that hardened washer. And then we've got the torque wrench, which is set at 50 lb-ft. You'll have to pardon the correct use of tools here, but anyway. With your steam viewing, hopefully you can see we've still got in-float there. Just the in-float of the bearing, nothing more. They're all good. I need to set up the selectors properly, you can hear them dragging at the moment. Anyway, happy with that. We can do the main shaft nut now. Now I'm going to torque the main shaft nut to 100 lb-ft. We need special tool 600-300 for that. So at this stage I'd normally be knocking over the tabs of the lock washer, but in this case of course we're fitting the overdrive, so we're not going to do that. And more to the point, none of them are actually lined up, which can happen. So at this stage what I'd do is take the nut back off again and turn the lock washer round, maybe a set of splines or two, and just try it again. You can always increase the torque slightly, but I wouldn't go too mad. Certainly don't want to decrease the torque, given the tendency for these to come loose. I don't know actually when this is going to get installed. It might be the spring, it might be spring in a couple of years time, so just trying to spread grease on all the bare metal surfaces, really, just to prevent things rotting away. So there's a bit of Heldite on that, we'll just let that go tacky and pop it on the gearbox. There's three nuts and three bolts for this. I've already copper slipped the studs, but Well, I say copper slip, I don't use copper slip, I use Rocol. It's a Rocol anti-seize compound, J166. Fantastic stuff. And it's actually quite good for tapping threads as well. You need a fantastic mix of spanners for these gearboxes. We've got AF fixings. They're 7/16 AF. We've got quarter Whitworth. And then on this gearbox as well, we've actually got metric fixings because it's a late series 3.
We're back to the gearbox project today. Very nice day out there actually. Unusual for January. It'd be really nice to take the Land Rover for a run. I haven't driven it for weeks, but we're still in lockdown here in the UK, so I guess it's keeping me off the salty roads, which is probably not a bad thing. Every cloud and all that. So during the week, packet of parts turned up for this with all the missing fixings, some airtight nuts, the studs that I was missing. Obviously they're not blacked to match the rest of the fixings, but I'm not going to worry about that, so they'll be inside. New bolts for the top cover, and that's where the gear selector unit bolts on. And I've actually just won a gear selector unit on eBay for just a tenner. It's an original one with O-ring type end on it rather than the rubber donut, which is a far better thing. So we'll have a look at that at some point. Anyway, today's job is to adjust the selectors and then we can fit the selector detents. We're pretty much there then. Well, I know this video's been a bit long-winded. I don't know what we're up to now, probably a couple of hours of video or something, but I did want to try and go into detail with this one. Hopefully we have done that. There's one thing I'd just like to bring up in the book before we do this, and that's that it says here that in relation to putting all the selectors together and putting the top cover on, it says that if a joint washer was not previously fitted under the top cover, then a joint washer should now be fitted. Well, I have never seen a serious gearbox with a gasket of any sort under the top cover. I've always used a bit of RTV sealant or something like that myself. Some people just put a smear of grease, but certainly on the earlier ones they never had it. So just thought I'd bring it up. Be interested to know what other people think of that, but I've never seen one myself. I think I'm just going to do my usual sealant, and the only place they normally ever seem to leak from is around the selectors, which is just about a given really.
So now I'm going to adjust the selector forks. There is a note relative to these later gearboxes about the position of the selector fork relative to the shaft. There's a measurement given, perhaps I'll just show you that in a minute. I've actually set this one up to that, however, the selector in the neutral position feels hard up against the first second gear synchronizer hub. And I don't really want the selector fork really riding the back of the selector groove. So what I'm going to do is loosen this and try and just move the fork so that we get a little bit of free play in the neutral position. I think that's a much nicer way of doing it. If that doesn't work, it's easy enough to come back and adjust it later. Otherwise, the handbook says that the selector forks should be adjusted to their mid position. So I think we'll start with the third, fourth one. So if I loosen that off, zoom you in so you can see a bit more. Right, now that spanner's a bit tight on there because it's a little bit burred, that bolt, but anyway, it'll be fine. You can see that the selector fork has quite a bit of movement. So it's quite nice to set them up so they all sit together. I've locked the middle one in the vertical position, so
So we'll hold that vertical. That's about the mid position there. Tighten that properly in a minute. Okay, so with the detent groove in the shaft kind of centered about the track there for the selector detents, I can feel that there's going to be just a little bit of free play and that the selector isn't riding the hub really hard. It's not dragging too badly either, so happy with that one. That's basically all I'm going to do with the first second one as well. Trouble with new spanners, most of my spanners are old and a bit worn and they fit things quite nicely, but there you go. So again, you can see there's quite a bit of free play in that. So again, you can see now we've got a nice bit of free play with the selector rod in the neutral position. This was the note that I'd remembered in the manual about setting up the first second selector shaft. It's actually to do with fitting ECM gears to pre-suffix D gearboxes, but they're the type of gears and this is the type of selector used in suffix D box, so it probably is relevant, but I found it seems to give a better result just sitting in the midpoint, so that's what I've done. But there it is, something to bear in mind. So the selectors are now adjusted. You didn't see me do the reverse, but I found that was in quite a satisfactory position anyway, so I've just nipped up the pinch bolts hard as I can. If you want to do it with a torque wrench, you'll need to take them all out again, and it's £20 foot. I'm now going to clean up the top surface, ready to put it together, and we'll get the detent springs and balls and bits and pieces that will go in this channel. Something to bear in mind is that these later gearboxes don't have a reverse stop in the transfer case, which operates on the end of the selector, but the earlier ones do, and that will need adjusting later on. Here we have all the bits for the selector detents. You've got these like bearing rollers, and then three ball bearings, three springs, two of them are the same, one different. So we'll pop those bits and pieces in, along with some new seals which come in the seal kit. And then fit these nice powder coated brackets on to keep it all in place. I've just put a smear of Heldite round the top, trying to keep it away from the selectors, and then a bit on the top cover as well. There's not a lot we can do about this area here, it will just leak from around there, they always do. But anything we can do to stop it all dribbling down the side of the gearbox is going to help. So hopefully that will do the job. Okay, so we can now put the little selector, the roller bearing ones as it were, selector detents in. The ones that look like a roller bearing, they go down in the centre there. Put a bit of grease on them, help them stick around. A magnet on a stick is quite good at this point, just in case you drop one into the gearbox. Stranger things have happened. This thing is the best £2 I've ever spent, and it saved me so many times. It just happens. And then we can actually put the other ones in once the top cover's on. So all my studs and bolts and things are copper slipped up. We've tightened the pinch bolts sufficient and it's all nice and oily in there, so hopefully we won't have to look in there for a little while. I'll just stop to take a quick photograph of that before I button it up. I've fitted the seal retainer on the top cover but left it a bit loose for the time being, so we'll nip that up once this is on there. I've mentioned Heldite a few times throughout this video. I was looking at a manual for a Rolls-Royce engine from the 1930s, and Rolls-Royce were using Heldite and Klingersyl in their aero engines in the mid-30s. It speaks volumes for those materials that they're still around. So using Heldite and Klingersyl in this gearbox, we've worked to Rolls-Royce standards, which is nice. But good materials, and I certainly recommend them. Never have any trouble. Right. Tins of Heldite are about £6, so it's quite cheap. It's cheaper than a tube of RTV. I personally don't like RTV sealant. I know some people like to use it on the top. I've done it myself. But it all oozes out and it gets in things, gets in the threads. It's, yeah, not my favourite. Now I'm going to fit the detent ball bearing and spring on each side. So make sure we've got the two identical springs, which we have. Interestingly, the service kit does come with new ones, but they're very much stronger than the originals, which you'd expect because they're new, but not the difference that they are. They're also actually shorter to start with, but so much stronger. I'm not going to use them. The original ones are in good nick anyway, so we'll put them in. And then on the outside goes the little rubber seal. Tucks into a counter bore in the casing, and you've then got to try and get your retaining plates on, which is always fun. Yeah. I've seen people use a clamp on these so they can clamp the two together and then wind the box in, but I think I can just about manage it. these little brackets are handed. I just noticed that, but I've got them on the right way round anyway, with the sort of the radius forwards. Yeah, that all looks good. Selectors are still free to move, but retained by the detents, which is good. I was almost forgetting, there's one more thing to do. So that brass plug that I modified for the clip for the little breather plug there, that comes out of there and has a detent ball bearing and spring for the first and second gear selector. The three ball bearings are all the same. So we just drop that down in there, followed by a spring, and it's the shorter spring of the three. I've now found homes for all the fixings at the back of the gearbox. The two long shank studs go up the top. There's one which has a smaller diameter thread as it goes in the gearbox. You want to watch out for that one when you tighten the box up. I discovered that some years ago. There's then sort of intermediate size, one of those there, one down there, and then a bolt through there. And obviously two bolts through the top cover. Well, that's about as far as we can go for the time being. I think some sort of an addendum to this series of videos is going to be necessary to pull it all together. There's quite a few things we still haven't covered, the various linkages and selectors and so on, that will all be fitted, or selector levers. So I think when I get to installing this in the vehicle, I will take some video of doing that. I'm thinking of doing it a different way this time, putting the gearbox in first and then bolting the transfer box on after that. So that'll make a comparison with last time. But yeah, we're pretty much there. You certainly can build one of these a lot quicker than I have. I've seen plenty of people throw them together in an afternoon, but I think if you want a gearbox that's going to give you really good service, then it's worth taking a bit of time. I do these things as a hobby, really, so there's no rush. I've taken my time to try and make it look reasonable. I'm quite pleased with how it's turned out. Won't stay looking like that forever, though. Well, that really is it for this one, so I'd like to just thank you for watching, and I hope the videos have actually been useful, and we'll see you again next time. Take good care.